Good evening and welcome to the special 60-minute edition of Left, Right and Center. I'm Sanket Upadhyay. Three stories we are tracking right here. Story number one, we have decided to dedicate a crucial part of our broadcast today to celebrate this sporting victory. Usually what happens is people talk about cricket a lot. They talk about some other sport. They talk about the Olympics. But when it comes to Paralympics, even the athletes feel that they are left behind somewhere as far as public glare is concerned. We will not do that. Athletes go for glory as at the Paralympics. Is it now time for a national movement for sports? We'll do our bit by highlighting the story right here at 9 p.m. Story number two, Mr. Sajjad Lone, who came out of the Gupkar Alliance, is called the Gupkar Disruptor. What really are his plans? A lot of people are now joining him, his political outfit. What exactly is on his mind? There is some criticism also that he could be taking certain votes away from the Gupkar Alliance and maybe in turn helping the BJP. Is that correct? We'll ask him these questions as he joins us at 9:30 p.m. And also on the show, Muslims are being attacked in MP and this is happening with alarming regularity. Alarming regularity. For the past 12 to 14 days, continuously there are instances being reported from both Madhya Pradesh as well as Uttar Pradesh. Is this fringe at play or majority ruling? And most importantly, are these the results of the politicians' experiments with hate? But first, let's quickly come back to that issue of celebration and recognition of our athletes who have gone for glory, who have given India glory at the Paralympics. The question that we are asking is whether it is time for a national movement around sports if it has not begun already. I still feel that we have a lot more to go before we can say that yes, we have a nation with a sporting temperament. I would like to welcome our first guest, Paralympian Rio 2016, Khel Ratan, Padma Shri, Arjuna Awardee, President of the Paralympics Committee of India, Madam Deepa Malik. Thank you very much, Deepa ji, for joining us. My first question, what a day this has been. Great day of celebration. I want to know from you, what went in your mind when these medals started coming in today?
I wish on the day of Janmashtami, I could get some superpowers of Lord Krishna and be present at many places at one time. What I have missed is that if a medal was being won here, I would miss the other one. And if I was there, wow, I would miss this one.
What a lovely
it has been
space
such
be in.
A day of a happy confusion for me.
Happy confusion.
But so wonderful. On a serious note, absolutely elated. This was something which I had always dreamt of.
Absolutely.
When I started my career of sports. And this is where I wanted to see India celebrating para sports. That has been my journey and it's amazing to see the same happening through these amazing 54 para athletes who are here and kudos to those who have not been able to win a medal because even if they have not, they have done better than their best and that speaks highly of their dedication and
True.
Training and coming to the ones who have created history by winning medal, they have won many hearts. Heart of Honorable Prime Minister, sir. He's been calling consistently. And I'm sure we have not let him leave the phone on a side today because after every 1 hour, there was a medal coming in. So, yes, a very happy day, a day of gratitude. Gratitude to Indian media. Gratitude to Indian citizens. The kind of love they are showering. And gratitude to these athletes and their coaches. And the training programs behind their journey.
True.
Target Olympic Podium Scheme, Sports Authority of India. The ministers from sports have been connected thoroughly and consistently with these athletes. Federation has made sure that athlete-centric approach has been taken. My being made a Paralympic committee's president itself speaks highly about the athlete-centric focus now. So yes, overall, an amazing kind of a collaboration. Would also like to thank the stakeholders, the sponsors. We don't have many. Hope we'll get many now.
Of course.
But with limited sponsorship and support of the government, we've been able to put up this show. And this one is a fantastic one for sure.
Absolutely. Deepa ji, I'll come to that point on sponsors and sponsorship a little later. I want to ask you, what do you think has changed over the years for a performance like this?
Firstly, the acceptance in the policies, which have become at par. The at par training facility and training funding program. The acceptance of para sports as mainstream sports. I have been trying to drive home this whole concept and literally had to win a medal to in Rio Paralympics to tell everybody that look, the color of my silver is same as PV Sindhu's and the color of a gold of Sumit Antil or Avni Lekra is similar to Neeraj Chopra's or Abhinav Bindra's. So respect our hard work, our challenges, our journeys, which are equivalent to any sports person. It is whether with disability or without disability. And what has changed majorly is acceptance at par. And governance understood that. They made at par policies. Now, people are also understanding that. That's a good news. The change initiated with the previous medals and have impacted today. And the other change is that the athlete themselves, along with their coaches, have become educated and evolved. They have understood the difference between a medal and a participation. And the difference is acceptance of an holistic approach. Acceptance of sports sciences in their training programs. So that has changed because till now, dhoot pile, ghee khale, ja phek de. Now there is a proper regime. There is science. They are talking about nutrition, mental health. They are talking about visualization exercises. They're talking about conditioning. They're talking about fitness levels. It is not just the skill. Earlier, an athlete used to go just with skill. Now the athlete is going with sports sciences, a holistic approach. And what has changed? The coaches are accepting these external forces.
Wow.
Otherwise, main coach hoon, main jo bolunga, wo karo. अब कोच बोलता है न्यूट्रिशनिस्ट से डाइट ले ली, फिटनेस ट्रेनर से आपने अपनी रिलैक्सिंग करा ली, फिजियोथेरेपिस्ट से मसल को इंजरी से बचा लिया. तो ये बदला है. दिस इज व्हाट हैज
चेंज्ड. दिस इज ग्रेट ग्रेट टू हियर. आई मीन यू आई जस्ट आस्क्ड दिस क्वेश्चन बट यू नो यू गेव मी अ स्पेक्टेक्युलर रिस्पॉन्स to be able to see that change. This is a really welcome change. But Deepa ji, you think, and now let's come back to the point on advertising. Do you think that this is a sad reality that sponsors and advertisers are not forthcoming for anything other than cricket? And maybe para athletes find themselves as the last in the list of priority?
I'll share my personal experience.
Yeah, please.
When I came back with the silver and I asked the advertising world, what about my my advertisement, back then. And I would see Sakshi Malik and I would see PV Sindhu there. And then one, I will not name the person, but in an inclusion summit, it was an inclusion summit where the person was there as a guest speaker. And that person, and told me that who wants to sell their products through an aged, crippled woman.
My God.
And it became a kind of a journey for me to make sure that at least advertisement campaign comes to a para-athlete. And we have just done a Tane Palatde campaign just before this.
We saw that.
We are very happy that the consistent 100-year-old partner with Olympics and IPC partner now, Coca-Cola has come up with this concept of, yeah, people must be watching it. It is Tane Palatde.
Yeah.
And things are changing. Things are changing. I'm sure we have very good looking athletes. Avni is a beautiful girl.
Now, why should that matter?
And we're not going to talk about looks. We're talking about their ability. Yeah. We're talking about the skill. Look at Sumit Antal. Such a handsome looking boy. Yogesh Khatunia. I mean, look at their faces beaming with confidence. I think beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder. Mm. So we have the beauty. You are the beholder. Can you conceptualize a beauty? And it's now the brand shift is also there. I have become the voice of an artificial intelligence mechanism in a car. Big B has done one AI and I have done another and they've been launched together. So, you know, I'm so thrilled and elated that has happened. Today only Anand Mahindra ji has tweeted and said that reaction to my tweet that he'll be gifting Avni a car with all the attachment of it being an accessible vehicle for a wheelchair user. So brands are taking note. They are, you know, coming forward and the shift is happening.
Good to hear. So good to hear. Thank you very much, Deepa ji, for joining us. And it was great talking to you. Let's hope that this change is initiated now. And we only go northwards from here. Thank you very much for joining us. I would like to introduce our guest, Vishal Uppal, captain of the Indian Billie Jean King Cup team, former Indian Davis Cup player. We also have Shemon Sharif, international shooter, Krishna Punia, international gold medalist, Indian discus thrower, and Charu Sharma, director of the Pro Kabaddi League. Charu, I would like to begin with you. I hope you remember the last time when you were here on the show. See, you're smiling. The last time you were here, you had a sharp critique for the media that you have boxed sporting achievements and sporting success to one corner or maybe even removed it. Here we are at 9 p.m. discussing this great achievement. Charu.
Well, Sanket, thanks for listening and then reacting and doing the right thing, because sports is it's a major national, you know, unity instrument. And all we do at 9 p.m. is, oh gosh, okay, let's not even go there. But I'm so glad, Sanket, that you've paid attention to sport. Thank you very much. And particularly Paralympics. Now, if in the regular able-bodied Olympics, we've reached 7 medals, and we're obviously giving a fair amount of push there or resources to able-bodied sports, and we've got 7 medals at the Olympics. At the Paralympics, we've already done that, and hopefully we might get a few more. And that is no less, in fact, more, because you know the whole world has equal access to Paralympics in terms of their performances and all the infrastructure that's provided. In India, I think Deepa has already mentioned that we were several steps behind the global average, should we say. And despite that, and despite the lack of support and the lack of recognition, how well have these athletes done? It's just absolutely magnificent. But the more important thing is that Sanket, you and NDTV is paying attention at a time when people pay attention to television. So that, I think, is more worthy of applause. Well, thank you. Well done.
You know, it's a bad time you've chosen to congratulate the media. We need to celebrate these athletes and celebrate them more. And that is the theme of this show. Krishna Punia ji, I want to come to you. You know, I asked this question in an earlier broadcast also when we were talking about Olympics. You tell me that beyond what we have already achieved, how can we speed up the pace of, building a national movement around sports in this country? You know, quick bullet points which can happen.
संकेत जी, सबसे पहले तो देशवासियों को बधाई. हमारे सात और स्टार चमक रहे हैं आज ओलंपिक मेडल के साथ, और देखिए, मैंने पहले भी अपनी डिबेट में बताया था कि जब तक हम इसे स्कूल लेवल पे लागू नहीं करेंगे तब तक जो चीजें हम सोच रहे हैं वो नहीं होने वाली, बिल्कुल भी नहीं होने वाली। क्योंकि जितने भी एथलीट आप उनकी जर्नी पे देखना कि जब उन्होंने स्पोर्ट्स शुरू किया था तो किस लिए किया था, क्या रीजन था उनका स्पोर्ट्स शुरू करने का, और जब आप रीजन देखेंगे तो मुझे लगता है कि वो अपने फ्यूचर को सिक्योर करने के लिए, जॉब ढूंढने के लिए उन्होंने किया होगा। और उसके बाद जब उन्हें लगा कि वो और आगे जा सकता है तो उसमें से चुनिंदा लोगों ने और आगे बढ़ने की कोशिश की और वो आज मेडल के साथ हैं। तो वो चुनिंदा ही क्यों है जब तक पार्टिसिपेट सन लेवल नहीं बढ़ेगा, जब तक हमारी एंट्री उसमें ज्यादा नहीं रहेगी तब तक जो टैलेंट है वो हमारा छिपा रहेगा, और तब तक हम इसी तरीके से डिबेट करते रहेंगे जब भी ओलंपिक, पैरा ओलंपिक, एशियन गेम, कॉमनवेल्थ गेम आते रहेंगे और तब तक। और जहां तक मैं सोचती हूँ कॉमनवेल्थ गेम, दिल्ली कॉमनवेल्थ गेम को इसका क्रेडिट देना चाहूंगी कि देशवासियों ने कुछ स्पोर्ट्स के बारे में जाना अपनी कंट्री में होने के बाद। जब वो गेम हमारे यहाँ हुए तो उसके बाद आप देख सकते हैं कि चाहे वो 2012 ओलंपिक में मेडल थे, रियो में हालांकि हमारे पास दो ही मेडल थे, लेकिन उसके बाद जैसे टोक्यो ओलंपिक का रिजल्ट रहा, अभी पैरा ओलंपिक का रिजल्ट रहा, तो ये एक अवेयरनेस आई है। और इसके साथ साथ मेरा एक चीज और भी कहनी है, क्योंकि जब चीजें कुछ कम हो तो उसे हमें सेलिब्रेट करना चाहिए और उन एथलीट्स की कहानी हर बच्चे तक पहुंचनी चाहिए कि किस तरीके से उन्होंने शुरू किया, क्या क्या हर्डल्स उनके सामने आए, बावजूद उसके उन्होंने ये अचीवमेंट ली है। ये चीजें हम सेलिब्रेट करेंगे अपने जूनियर्स के साथ एक करेंगे तो उन्हें मोटिवेशन मिलेगा और आगे बढ़ने की प्रेरणा मिलेगी। तो सबसे पहले वही है कि स्कूल लेवल से शुरू होना चाहिए।
आई थिंक दिस इज अ ग्रेट पॉइंट दैट यू हैव मेड। देयर नो लेस देन यू नो सोल्जर्स, they need to be celebrated like that. We've come around respecting soldiers, books are being written about them. The same needs to happen for these athletes also, to celebrate their success, maybe to motivate others. But Mr. Sharif, I want to come to you now. You know, this point that Deepa Malik was also mentioning about sponsorship, money essentially. See, any sport requires both time as well as financial investment. And that is what is a huge problem for, you know, Paralympics. So, how do you convince sponsors that, you know, you can, what are you looking for? Bang for your buck. Look at this as a good investment. You will get that bang. Shimon, yeah, you Sanket, have to unmute yourself.
Yes, yes, sorry.
You so silenced yourself, even, not me.
So before answering that, Sanket, I'll just say something which you were trying to compare an athlete with the soldier. You're absolutely right. You know, an athlete, when he or she wins a medal, that's the only time when you see the national flag going up in a foreign country. And when you win a gold medal, that's the only time and that's the only way you get the national anthem played of your country in a foreign land. So yes, both soldiers and athletes need to be celebrated. They are true heroes. And now about the sponsorship. Sanket, Deepa Malik was just giving you an example. I'll give you a very short example of my own thing. When I was in the Indian shooting team, I was speaking to some brands for some support. So they turned around and told me, "Are you are from a sport which involves guns." So, you know, what I'm trying to make a point is that, you know, people don't understand, the corporate world does not understand the difference between, you know, probably, you know, they don't know that they don't have that kind of knowledge, how they can associate and take mileage out from
so
a
silly.
Particular sport.
You know, it's utterly silly because you've got a movie made on shooter dadis. That's the amount of investment people are about, you know, making. And
absolutely.
To have heard something like this is, what do I say, preposterous. Please carry on. Yeah.
Right. And you know, these are stories of determination, of never giving up. These are fantastic stories. So obviously, you know, sponsors can definitely associate with these stories, with these athletes, and gain a lot of mileage out of this. And I remember in that last show also, I was also a part of the panel.
Yeah.
We were talking about ROI. And I think the what
Charu.
Bigger ROI than to see your flag and your national anthem being played in a foreign country through these athletes, through these heroes.
Absolutely. I still remember Charu said R-O-N-P.
N-P,
yes.
Correct.
Return yes, Charu said. On national pride. That was the phrase. I want to come to Mr. Uppal now. Mr. Uppal, your inputs on how to keep this momentum going. See, right now the Olympics and the Paralympics have happened in quick succession. So there is still fervor, celebration. But sadly what happened, and today it was really great to see, Neeraj Chopra tweet for Mr. Antil. But what happens when this momentum goes? And we've seen that happening in this country.
Actually, the Paralympics are always held right after the Olympics. But anyway, sorry, go ahead, Vishal.
Yeah, but Sanket, firstly, I want to congratulate the medal winners today and all the Paralympic athletes who were there. They're champions in my book, irrespective of whether they win a medal or not. What they've done is simply phenomenal and inspirational. Now, coming to your point, I think, one of the things has to happen is guys like us, guys like Charu, who've been a part of the system and who've gone through the, getting beaten up with the sponsors, asking them, begging them, please, please, please help us. I think we also need to take a bigger step forward and, push the case of the current generation through a lot more. Think about it. 98%, Charu can correct me if I'm wrong, but 98% of the corporate sponsorship goes into cricket. And cricket is a sport played by 8 nations. I'm not trying to beat up on cricket here, but that's the reality. And Olympics and Paralympics are, over 200 nations. And we're just not investing enough in our athletes from whatever level they start at. Punyaji said that we need to start at a school level, but I have to kind of agree with what Charu had said last time, that if we start at the school level now, we're going to have this debate again 4 years down the road. We'll have it 8 years down the road. We need to invest in our present right now. We need to start investing in them right away so that we can make them success stories. And while we're doing that, make sure that we start this school program and educating. I think two kinds of people that we really need to educate in this country about sport is parents and educationists. Because even till today, schools will make kids give up their sporting and aspirations because of academics. They will say, nahi padoge, fail ho jaoge. The fear factor of that is tremendous in this country. And you can't fight that. So I think we need to really stop saying, let's do it. Okay, we'll look at it. We need to start doing things now, right away. We have Asian Games in 2 years. Let's not just focus on 2 years Asian game. Let's start focusing on our 12, 14, 16 year old kids who are actively participating in sport. And most importantly, let's not look at sport, all the sports, with the same brush. Let's not look at them with the same eye. Every sport has different requirements.
Interesting.
We need to start catering how we deal with every sport based on their requirements. Not every sport is a team sport. Not every sport is an individual sport. We need to look at sports, what each sport specifically demands, and then give that to our athletes to help our athletes grow. One of the biggest things, and I think I give kudos to BCCI for this, for coming up with the IPL concept. Look at the talent they've unearthed. It's incredible. They've gone to the hinterland and look at the talent we're seeing in cricket coming up. Now, let's say, let's take any sport. Why are we not organizing more international competition in our country so that we can give more athletes opportunities to play international competition in our country? We have the money. Let's not say I was watching the Kabaddi the auction that's happening. One athlete is being sold for 80 lakhs, a crore. We have money in IPL auction. One athlete is going for 15 crores. Do you know that 15 crores you put in a sport, what a big difference that will make
Absolutely.
To the entire sporting structure?
We have the money. Please invest it smartly. Charu, towards the end, that point on Kabaddi players, you have been affiliated with the Pro Kabaddi League, you're the director. I want to know from you, what has your experience been? Nobody would have thought that there will be a Pro Kabaddi League, but here we are. What are the problems that you're facing? If you want to tell us.
I mean, Of course, I'd love to tell you, except that I need a few days. So let's not go there. Well, it took me 4 years to set it up. And I'm really, truly delighted that the Viva Pro Kabaddi League has achieved the heights it has. And Vishal mentioned the figures. Yeah, I mean, Pardeep Narwal went for 1.65 crores. So some great individual stories, because the sport has gone professional. And let's forget about the problems I face, because there's no point now, you know, lamenting those. Sure. But all I can say is that the nation, and to an extent, the commercial situations around Kabaddi have woken up. Now, of course, they can happen around lots of other sports and lots of other sports persons as well. And we come back to Paralympics. All it takes is, I mean, there's a lot of championing to be done. Deepa's doing that, obviously, because she's a great ambassador for the whole concept of Paralympics, you know, having been there and done that herself. I think people will wake up. Sometimes, once again, I use the word patience, Sanket, because, you know, we get very impatient. Now, there's been terrific success at the Paralympics this time around, Tokyo 2020. But because of this, more support will come. And you might say it's a chicken and egg situation. I mean, or a cart and a horse. Why must people have to, with great struggle, achieve, and only then will support come? But that's the nature of things, Sanket. I mean, people love winners. And that's how, you know, when winners somehow magically happen because of their own hard work and not because of a system, true, even though the system's a lot better now. Deepa was talking about how now there's professionalism even in Paralympics. Yeah. But this success will draw people. There's no doubt about it. It's going to be drop by drop. But let's take that in a nation like ours, for other sports apart from cricket, even if it's drop by drop, but it's an additional drop. Correct. And it will help and it will take it forward.
Correct.
So, you know, I want to see this more optimistically. I think more people will come. Our advertising industry, God bless them, you know, Deepa's talking about ads, which is not the only way that commerce comes in. I mean, that's only for the individual athlete. Of course, it does bring some attention. But, you know, they'll show a scenario where there's, oh, last ball, six required and what have you. And they'll show people in pristine whites and a new ball coming in. You know, I'm saying it's the last ball. What are you doing with a new ball? So the advertising industry is kind of, you know, a little suspect on that score. But they will wake up to all of this. And I hope there's a new nationalistic fervor of taking sport as a true blue heroic scenario and, you know, throw all these people up as heroes. It will happen.
That was the reason why, you know, the comparison with the soldiers. Thank you very much to all of you all. Let's just hope, as far as sponsors are concerned, this opinion that they had secretly, obviously Deepa did not mention the name, that who will invest in a wrinkled, crippled old woman? Hope this opinion changes. That's how you bring about change. Thank you very much to the four of you for joining us. We're stopping for a short break at this moment. Yes.
Real quickly, Sanket, I'm going to disagree with Charu on your show. Last time, Hina agreed completely. I'm going to disagree with it. Time has run out. We are done with being patient. We've heard this dialogue since
My time has also run out. So we will lose commercials. See, it's all about sponsors. No, so let's not lose commercials. We will host a debate again. I promise you, sports will be taken very, very, Indian sports will be taken very, very seriously right here on NDTV. Thank you very much for celebrating this great win. We're stopping for a short break at this moment. When we come back, our special interview with Sajjad Loan. Is he the Gupta disruptor? Welcome back. So lots of interesting developments happening as far as Jammu and Kashmir is concerned, Jammu and Kashmir politics is concerned. So there's this gentleman who was part of the People's Alliance for Gupkar Declaration, which is known as PAGD, the Gupkar Alliance. But early this year, he said, I'll go my own way. And since then, consistently, a lot of people are quitting their positions and slowly joining Mr. Sajjad Loan and his party. What's really happening in Jammu and Kashmir right now, in the politics of Jammu and Kashmir? And how does one explain this slow but steady exodus to Mr. Sajjad Loan's party?
Congress leader Haji Farooq is the latest entrant into the People's Conference led by Sajjad Loan. Loan, a former minister in PDP-BJP government, has quit the Farooq Abdullah Mehbooba Mufti Gupkar Alliance earlier this year over lack of coordination and trust. Since then, an estimated dozen leaders have joined him, many from the Mufti's PDP.
ये जो कारवान ऑफ चेंज है इसमें जो इतने बड़ी शख्सियत आ रहे हैं इंशाल्लाह मुझे पूरा यकीन है कि हम आने वाले कल में जो चैलेंजेस हैं जम्मू कश्मीर उन सबको हम एक ऐसी टीम कौम को देंगे इंशाल्लाह जो ग्राउंड से उठे।
Sajjad Loan, once referred to by Prime Minister Modi as his younger brother in 2014, was among scores of political leaders, including three former chief ministers who were arrested after abrogation of Jammu and Kashmir's special status in August 2019. A bitter Loan had then said, the centre's decision was short-sighted and born out of hatred. Today, his critics say his party is once again being backed by the centre. However, Loan remains determined on restoration of Jammu and Kashmir's statehood. Unlike Gupkar Alliance, Loan is silent on restoration of Jammu and Kashmir's special status. Gupkar Alliance politics is based on its restoration. Gupkar Alliance demands statehood before elections are held, but Loan demands restoration of statehood but does not link it with the elections.
I feel it an honor and privilege with me, my colleagues too, that we are part of People's Conference. And there is one another reason. People's Conference is almost 50-year-old party and we are proud to be associated with Sajjad Ghani Loan Saab.
There's no clarity when assembly elections will be held in Jammu and Kashmir, but for the first time in last 2 years, politics is gaining some momentum in Kashmir. Many political leaders are joining People's Conference and Sajjad Loan seems to be flavor of the month. In Srinagar, Nazir Masoodi, Find TV.
Joining us right now is the man himself, chairman of the Jammu and Kashmir People's Conference, Mr. Sajjad Loan. Mr. Loan, good evening. Must be music to your ears that a lot of people are now affiliating with the JK People's Conference.
Yeah, in fact, it is a good thing. We have struggled for a very long time. My father founded this party in 1978. And traveled through many upheavals, a lot of rigged elections, and finally moved towards separatism. And I think one of the main reasons would have been lack of trust in the election machinery, a lot of rigged elections, partly maybe some other ideological factors. Mm. Then I came back into mainstream. I struggled too. I fought a parliament election, lost my deposit. Then our party fought, lost our deposit again. Then we fought assembly elections. And here we are trying to get as many people on our side as possible.
Sajjad Saab, in this report filed by Nazir Masoodi, he did say and referred, and this is a point which is being mentioned a lot by your critics. And they also see this as some sort of an alliance or a gadbandhan that you have with the Bharatiya Janata Party. That Modi called you his younger brother, right? Now, with you coming out of the Gupkar Alliance, people associating and affiliating with you, are you going to be seen as some sort of a moderate face for the BJP in the valley as an opposition to the Gupkar Alliance?
This is the new flavor of the month, as Nazir was saying, is that anybody daring to come up in Kashmir will now be branded as a BJP guy. Sanket, I'll tell you something. In Kashmir, there is conflict, there is violence. People are victims of a discourse. A vicious discourse is started and then ends up in an assassination, as happened in my father's case. These discourses are nothing short of attempts, intentionally or unintentionally, for future assassinations. Could be me, could be my party workers. These discourses are started from studios like yours, from our great leaders who have 300-400 people guarding them, SSG securities, right? And they make the threat perception of people who are unguarded at the village level, say my worker, or somebody like me with 4 or 5 PSOs. They make them so insecure and finally it ends up in an assassination. I would beg that, not for my sake, for those who are in the field, let us put an end to this nonsense. Mm. Shah Faisal came up, he was an IAS officer. The poor fellow first decided to join NC. At that time, he was an angel. Then he decided not to join NC and all of a sudden he became a stooge of the BJP and he was hounded out.
Yeah.
Anybody daring to go beyond the traditional families is branded either as a traitor or as a BJP guy. Now, Sanket, please let me speak. I really want to speak. I may not be hungry to speak.
Please carry on. Yeah.
What has Delhi done for me? There are two families. Delhi has done whatever, given them power in 75 to NC, in 87 rigged elections, gave them power in 1996, elections in name, three times given power on a plate. My father used to fight from Handwara 40 years back, and they used to rig his polls. He would still win. I am fighting from the same Handwara. Got nothing. What am I doing? I'm struggling on the ground. And there are these elites with a lot of friends in Delhi who conjure up these surreal theories of he now being a BJP guy. Now you tell me, I leave it to you, what would it take for these people to accept someone as not being BJP but people still joining them? You know, anybody who shows some traction, either with people joining them or people at the mass level, they will say he is a stooge. I hopefully in the month of October will hold one of the biggest rallies by the grace of God.
Okay.
Would those people also have been sent by BJP? I have held rallies, perhaps some of the biggest rallies here. These people, are they all, from BJP? This is pure nonsense. And this is, unfortunately, a discourse which keeps up coming and again and again. Whenever somebody tries to do something out of the box. Yeah.
But do you feel, Sajjad Saab, that, this common cause for which you also joined the Gupkar Alliance, you are or were a misfit in the larger scheme of things or in their form of politics? For instance, you are criticized for your silence on the restoration of 370 and not abrogation.
Look, how first of all, let me tell you one thing. I am a person who was a separatist, who has seen jail, who has seen torture. I've been hung upside down. I am not a chocolate boy or a chocolate girl. I have not grown up in the laps of agency uncles, right? I have seen it the hard way. Okay, I've been hit, slapped, kicked. So I'm no chocolate boy, right? So let them not put it on me. They were a misfit with someone who has been interrogated. I've not grown up in the laps of agency uncles and aunties, okay? Now,
you might as well want to name them, Sajjad Saab. This is like no,
I really don't. No, the uncles and aunties will get angry with me. So I won't, right? So, I talk about Article 370 because I want it to be restored. I don't want to make a noise about it. I want it to be restored. Look, I'll tell you something. I have seen 30 years. I have been in jail. I have seen my friends go to jail. I have friends in jail even today, right? Who have been jailed by these people, okay? Now, you tell me, what is the bigger role in J&K? Saving people or getting them jailed? It's very difficult when you send someone to jail. It's very difficult when you get someone killed. In 2010, 120 people died. 2016, I was in the government, people died. Is anybody even naming them today? No, lost. So, Article 370, yes. But there has to be a strategy. I don't want to make a noise for the sake of a noise. We have a policy. We will talk about it. And let me tell you one thing. PAGD does not have the moral right to talk about 370, and anybody not aligning with it is not seeking restoration of 370. So,
no, but then Sajjad Saab, if you could spell this out clearly so that your critics know, do you stand for the restoration of 370 or not? In whatever way?
Of course I do. Of course I do.
Okay.
And the only thing is that I don't want to make a noise which angers the people of India. In jail, while we were talking to our friends, and even today I believe that we have to reach out to the people of India because Article 370 has to be restored in Parliament, not in J&K Assembly. We have to reach out to the people of India. We can't anger them. We can't incite them.
So you do, we have to bring them, you do admit right, that the people of India do not give in to your wish of the restoration of 370. And thus, no, it is seen as an anti-India thing to do, or in terms of sentiment.
They have been misled by their own leadership and also by the, at times, irresponsible utterances that we make. Right? We have to reach out to the people of India because that's a reality. You can get Article 370 back either on the floor of the parliament or in the court. There is no third forum. So I'm saying we'll reach out to the people of India. We want it back, right? But it has to be given by the people of India. Courts will take a very long time, a very, very long time. And as on date, I think it would be safer. No, that would be, I won't say anything about the courts, but let's talk about the parliament. But, as long as we don't convince them, and that's the whole difference. I don't want to play to the galleries in Kashmir at the cost of Article 370 in the court of the people.
And you think that this is also the popular view in Kashmir, and which is why more people want to associate with your way of going about rather than the Gupkar way of going about things? Which is
you
why
see, we talked, when somebody comes to me, it is a long process. I talk to him, our leadership talks to him. We tell him what our stand is on Article 370. We tell them what our stand is on statehood. We tell them what our stand is on developmental issues. How we will do things differently if we are in power, right? And yes, many people want to change. There has been change all across India. Sanket, why don't you understand one thing? That the only time a PDP could emerge was in 2002 when there was a non-Congress BJP government. Mm. Okay? At that time, the NC said, it's a creation of the BJP. Today, they are in the alliance with the PDP in PAGD. Okay? Now, what I'm saying is not rhetoric. You can check it.
But still then you were also part of a BJP-PDP government.
Yeah, that is in 2014. I'm talking of 2002.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
When PDP came to power, at that time they said, the normal and National Conference rhetoric was that they've been created by the IB and the BJP. Mm-hmm. Right? I felt at that time it was the struggle of Mufti Muhammad Sayyid, which saw the advent of a new party called PDP. What liberal media like yours, so-called liberal media, and I would love to say it's the most illiberal media I've ever seen. Okay. Because in Kashmir, they digested rickings. They digested much bigger things, right? They digested human rights abuses. Mm. They closed their eyes. Gandhi ji ke teen bandar. Kuch dekha bhai nahi. Kuch suna bhai nahi. Kuch bola bhai nahi. And then all of a sudden, these liberals, they get these liberal pangs when something, their traditional parties are, at a risk. Mm. Of people's power sweeping them away, they get these liberal or illiberal pangs, right? So, Sanket, I'll tell you something. Better do your homework and see why is it that whenever there has been a Congress government at the center, no other regional party has been able to come up. That is the homework I think the liberal or the illiberal media in Delhi needs to do.
I don't know for whom this criticism is. I've done my homework on you and I started interviewing you with good wishes. And then I ended up with brickbats from you. Wonder why. Thank you so much, Sajjad Sahab, for joining
us. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
All right, moving on now to story number 3. So, what is happening in Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh is that over the past few days, particularly the past 2 weeks, you have a situation where the fringe has come to the fore. Muslims are being targeted. This is targeted violence. They are not being allowed to do business. They are being asked to chant slogans, say Jai Shri Ram. All sorts of things are happening. The recent case from Mathura where Srinath Chaat Bhandar, Srinath Dosa Center was being run by a Muslim. So he was beaten up. The poor guy had to change the name of his shop to America Dosa Center. What sort of an environment is this? And is this all orchestrated, created by hate-filled politics? I want to welcome our two guests, Dr. S.Y. Qureshi, former Chief Election Commissioner. We also have P.K.D. Nambia, political analyst, supports the BJP. I want to come to you, Dr. Qureshi. There is a lot being said that, political parties don't really, and this divide is there on both sides. Hindu-pleasing parties and Muslim-pleasing parties also. They trump up hate. And then they say, we did not ask anyone to violently attack anyone else. That's their recourse. Do you give in to an argument like this, and would you want to treat this as the handiwork of a few fringe players? Or do you see this as a larger manifestation of someone's hate agenda?
Absolutely, it is a part of a larger script. definite hate agenda to polarize the country. The administration, the government cannot be blind. Don't they see it happening? Maybe they don't see the Godi media channels because they don't show them anyway. Now, the fact that it is happening with such regular frequency and the top leaders of the country and the state are silent. So silence is complicity. That is the old adage and wisdom. So it is no longer the matter of fringe elements. It is totally mainstream and as per the script.
Okay. PKD Nambiar, before I come to you, on the Coup app, we asked a question and there was a poll also that we conducted. Let's take a look at the findings of that poll and then I'll get you the question as well. So on the Coup app, the question that we asked was, who is to blame more for the targeting of Muslims in UP and MP? Hate politics, hate media, or fringe groups? So you can see hate politics is at 32%. Hate media is at 44%. So media is responsible, according to Indians on Coup, and fringe groups at 23%. This is the question that we asked. I want to ask you, Mr. PKD Nambiar, you know, a condition that has been created like this, even if you go by this poll, hate media and hate politics form the bulk of the people's perception of why what is wrong on the street is wrong. Mr. Nambiar, it's your experiment.
Sanket, firstly, isolated cases which has been handled locally by the police, and in most of these cases, these incidents, the cases have been charged by the police in respective
cases. I will tell you what has happened in isolated cases, Mr. Nambiar, in these isolated cases, in some of the cases, the victim himself, there is an FIR against him. So that is also a
Sanket,
problem.
May I expect the same time what you had given to Qureshi Saab,
sure.
So that as in my initial comment. There are large number of isolated cases has been portrayed in the national media, a section of national media to create some kind of a Hindu phobia in this country. Some amount of fringe elements are there in every religion, every political party, in every section of the society, whether they do not have any specific religion or colors. In the Mewat region of Haryana, there is large number of incidents which has happened, which was there in the public domain, in social media, in the viral videos, but there was no discussion by NDTV on that. If you want, I will send you a few of them, which is still circulating on the media. Hmm. Today, as we discuss in this particular case, discussion, this is the 100th year of Muslim riot of which happened, or Hindu genocide which happened in the Malabar region of Kerala, which is called even the Mahatma Gandhi, Ani Besant, and Dr. Ambedkar.
Mr. Nambiar, what does this have to do with MP and UP?
No, I wanted to tell you this. Why is it in these are the part of not in India? Is it not
no,
a part
of course,
of
but
India?
Right now we are
what
talking
I'm
about
trying
these
to tell
acts
you
of targeted
no,
violence.
No, no,
you are saying that if something has happened in Mewat, you know, we'll report
Sanket,
it.
Sanket, wrong. This is no. You haven't. You haven't, Sanket. Not only you and many people, many channels like you have not reported. What I am saying is that while I criticize such kind of incidents wherever it take place, whether it is UP, MP, Kerala, Maharashtra, or the Delhi, what we all need to have is that the fringe elements of every religion, every society needs to be treated and created in the same fashion.
No, not created.
Not in an isolated case. No, one second, Sanket. No, this will not be right. In isolated cases, which we have selectively taken up and trying to brand certain places and certain sections of the society, they are all bad, and trying to create a Hindu phobia in this country. Even Qureshi Saab, I respect him so much. We often meet in multiple channels. But then the only thing which I feel is that don't create such an isolated incident as a national.
No, but this is not isolated. The way I look at it, look at this. These are instances of the past 12 days. Mr. Nambiar,
to tell you the incident.
One moment. Mr. Nambiar, you've spoken. Equal amount of time has been given, so you can't hold that against me. The point is that these are not isolated cases. Pick them up and you'll realize that over the past 10-12 days, it almost appears like a synchronized attack against all those Muslims who are carrying or going about their daily life, their business. And I feel that this is a direct reflection of politics of hate.
That's the point. Sanket, this is where you are making a biggest mistake.
How?
You are not only making a biggest mistake, you are also doing an injustice to the society at a large, wherein we are trying to create. By highlighting such cases. I am telling you, you are highlighting selective. I am only saying you are only highlighting selective cases of your choice.
So you criticize
so
this?
That no. to create,
I will highlight other cases also. This. We will criticize and question other cases also, but that cannot be a justification for this, Mr. Nambiar. Very quickly,
Sanket, I will accept what you are saying today. If you do a show tomorrow on the incidents which has been taking place in the last 3 years, forget about the past, in the Haryana, in the Mewat region.
Sure, Mewat region.
If
okay,
the Hindus
challenge accepted, we will do
if
it.
You do a show.
And then tomorrow Mr. Nambiar will not say ever again. That there is selective, reporting.
Absolutely.
Or anything.
I
will report.
I am a challenge. Man of my
Mr. Nambiar, challenge accepted.
My words, I will.
Mr. Nambiar,
challenge accepted tomorrow
okay.
at the same time.
Okay.
Tomorrow at the same
Dr.
time.
Dr.
But
Qureshi,
I would like
you
to
can't
show
decide
all
my rundown. No, I will do the program. Dr. Qureshi, I want to come to you now. Do you feel that this is a problem which plagues all ecosystems? It's there in Muslims also. You've got hate politics in Muslims. You've got hate politics being done. And they just love this constituency of hate that they've created.
No, hate politics has been around. Yes, I agree with you. But for the last few years, it is only the Muslims who have been at the receiving end. No Muslim is in a position to hit back at all. And even in Mewat, which Mr. Nambiar is talking about, there is a BJP government. So why are they not controlling it? And does he mean that these are revenge attacks for something which happened in Kerala 100 years ago? I would like Mr. Nambiar himself to first condemn these 12 days incidents. What does he think of them? Instead of diverting the issue to 100 years and 50 years and other places, what about these 12 days?
No, to be fair, he did criticize.
No,
he did say, but then very briefly,
I
then moved on to his point. Okay, one more before you answer. On the Coup app, we asked a question. Who do you think is to blame for this? And there are some viewers also who have spoken out. They say, why do politicians use common people always to fight for religion? Why not for peace? Mr. Nambiar, would you like to answer that? Why is hate such a favorite with politicians?
So the hate is, that is precisely what I said. Firstly, I wanted to, because Qureshi Sahab is such a senior person, I wanted to say very clearly, not only these 12 days, every bad element and every incident which is attacking another individual is not acceptable and condemnable, and the police of the authorities should take the stand. That is my stand. There is no change in it. Now coming to the second part of it, whatever you are saying on the coup, the idea is that the challenge is that we are all here for peace. We are projecting a certain incidents, whether it is one, two or three, in a large country like us. We are doing an injustice and creating a phobia, whether it is Islam phobia or a Hindu phobia, which is not going to do good for the society.
It is not going to do good, but I just feel that if on
the
ground, it is my... I've run out of time, Dr. Qureshi, as well as Mr. Nambiar, thank you very much. But if on the ground, we get pictures, verified pictures of people being targeted because of their religion, not being allowed to go about their lives, being told that chant this slogan, otherwise we'll beat you up. This is not justified and it will be questioned. News and updates will continue right here. That's a wrap on this edition of Left, Right and Center. Thanks for watching.